Hello, welcome back to the new topic of video, which is muting, trace editing and absorption of the seismic data. So in this video, we are going to have some introduction and how we perform this type of things during the seismic data processing. So in the end of this lecture or the video, you will be able to analyze how the seismic data is recovered back without noise or unnecessary signals. So because when we are recording our seismic data, it is recorded together with signal and noise. So how you have to differentiate and how you have to remove the noises and recover your seismic signal. So that will be focus of this video. So in that, we will be following these steps, which is the muting, trace editing, as well as deghosting or Q attenuation filters. So the first of all, the trace editing, actually this is why we do need to do the seismic trace editing. So because sometimes if you have some dead geophone, so let's say if you have plotted a wrong geophone or this is not working, then probably you will have some of the bad traces or the dead traces. So sometimes also you have bad geophone planted. So let's say if you have the sampling interval or the interval of the geophone is 10 meters or let's say 5 meters. And then if you have plotted number of different geophone in between that sampling or the distance. So that is also caused as a bad trace, bad geophone plotted. And sometimes you have to do the seismograph amplifier failure. So sometimes you cannot record the signals from some of the geophone. Let's say this is one of the example. So you don't have any strong amplitude recorded in this geophone, in this trace. And sometimes if you're doing some seismic data recording in some area where you have the culture noise, so that will be also recorded there. So you have to remove that noise from the data set. And another factor, which is a poor near surface condition. Sometimes you have the boulders or you have some unconsolidated material. Because of that, you have the effect of high amplitude in the geophone. So what are the effects of this? These cause sometimes you have the bad part of the trees like this. You have very bad part of this trees over here is shown like this one. Another thing can happen, the energy arriving prior to the first identifiable reflection signal. So sometimes let's say all signals are coming here, which is the reflection here, but this is the arrivals coming before this signal. So this probably is considered as a bad trace of the energy arriving prior to the identifiable reflection signals. And it can be done either automatically or you can do the manually. Sometimes the automatic filter does not work, so you have to do manually. So one of the factor, which is the ground roll, which is normally in the land case, you have a very high amplitude and low frequency signals, which is called the ground roll. So that one is also can be removed. So the muting is actually for reflected waves and the directed wave. It's actually to ensure the coherent energy is not appears on CDP or either the stack section, since it can easily be misinterpreted as a shallow reflection energy. Another factor which we are considering the muting is actually the reflected energy. Identification is difficult on CDP or the stack section. Sometimes the reflection energy has a linear move out on the field file. So that one is also caused because of this effect. So sometimes the unmute reflected energy appears structurally significant, coherent reflection event and in the stack data or CDP data set. So this is also sometimes you have to consider either you are removing or muting the right trace or not the right trace. So for that, you have to understand what type of traces are recorded in your data set. So there is a standard procedure, and also some other software have different procedure probably. So first you have to define the time window. Then you have to define the taper length, which allows the gradual attenuation of the trace amplitude, and then its abrupt truncation produce a complex sine functions. Then you can use the frequency filter to attenuate the unwanted noise, and then you can fine tune the mute taper, maybe necessary if you need. So I will show you one of the example, how does this work. And actually, let's say if you have this short gather data. So here I'm showing you the top bottom surgical mute. So normally I will give you one example. Let's say if you want to do the top mute, let's say you want to remove this first break or the first reflection energy, let's say, because this is a synthetic data, probably there is no noise over here, but in the real field, you have a lot of noises here. So once you consider the top surgical mute, top mute, then you have to define like this one. So this red one is, once you define your top, then the energy which is above this one. So over here you can see the there is a lot of energy. So I'm just showing you one example, but actually this is the reflection which no need to remove. But in case if you have the noises here, then you can have this top mute like this. So once you define the top mute, then the above energy will be removed, and you will have the refined signals. And even if you want to pick one trace like this one, the red one I have picked, so this one energy can also be removed from the data set. So there is also some surgical mute. Surgical mute is normally is like a polygon, or you can define the top and bottom. So it is actually used to remove the bad traces segment, and which is normally caused by noise from the ear couple waves. So sometimes you have the noise on the ear waves, so which is over here. Normally this surgical mute you can define from the top and bottom, so this part can be removed. And the electronic interference, sometimes you have the power induction lines, so that one also can be removed from the muting, and also some can be removed by the filtering techniques which we have discussed in the previous lecture. So the ground rule, which is actually the constraint to isolated portion, so which is a very very obvious noise, and actually it happens in all land data keys. So this is a ground rule. So this was in the reflections, and so this ground rule also can be removed from the surgical mode. And sometimes you have the high amplitude noise that should be removed. So this is normally addressed to the ground, which is high amplitude and low frequency noises. So in the end of this, actually, once you are removing this noises, then you have to be very careful so that you no need to remove some signal which is looking as a noise, but actually it is a signal. So if the noise amplitude is low, then we have to use the multi-trace stacking process. This will also suppress the noise. So let's say if you have some noises which is not very visible in the seismic data, then you can use the stacking, multi-trace stacking procedure. So there are various stages of filters that can attenuate noise. So either you can do during muting, and then also you can do during filtering techniques. So some of the noises can be removed from there. And then to have the accurate geological interpretation, a good judgment is needed during the preliminary stage of seismic data processing. So that's why this course is actually will consist some initial interpretation on the seismic data which we have processed. So another factor which is geometrical spreading. So we use actually the pre-stack filter. So actually once we are sending our signals and which recorded at the surface, it is not enough to interpret the geology of the subsurface and locate the hydrocarbon. So first of all, we have to go for many processing flows which we are already discussing. But another factor is geometrical spreading. So in case of we have the constant velocity in the subsurface, you see the reflection, the energy which is on the top will be a mirror image at the bottom, either it's in any depth, so it will be very constantly increasing. But in case of increasing velocity with depth, which is actually the real case, in that case we have 1/V squared into t. So which is, v is the velocity and t is your travel time. So the problem is caused in this type of structure or in this type of subsurface geometry. So we have the amplitude decay in the data and the domination of individual large amplitude. And it's difficult to recognize the reflection event over here in this case. And there's a strong amplitude contrast influence the digital filtering. So these type of effects, when we are considering the constant velocity, then there is absorption of the amplitude. So this can be improved by Q attenuation, which is called the absorption. So there's two factors, which is in the seismic data, which decay our amplitude. So one is the offset and another thing is the depth. So once you have the energy over here, I mean, once you are going away from the source, I mean, your amplitude decay with the offset, and as well as amplitude will decay with the depth. So these are the two factors which we have to consider. So for that, we have to apply the geometric correction, geometrical correction. So in homogeneous media, you can apply with this expression to recover your amplitude. And for the layer space, let's say you have the inhomogeneous media, which is the variable velocity with depth. So in that case, you can use this expression. So there are some advantages of using this expression, so which is actually physical base for amplitude correction, and the relative amplitude difference remains the equal. So it will, let's say if you increase the amplitude at this 1 second, like by 10%, then obviously the 10% will be increased in the 2 second, 3 second, and so on. And there are some disadvantages of this procedure. So which is actually the velocity function is not known beforehand, and the noise source can still remain dominant. If you have increased the noise, then signal, then the noise will also increase. So another thing which is called the Q attenuation. So Q is a very important factor, which is actually propagate through inhomogeneous and anisotropic rock, produce the frequency dependent attenuation due to the scattering and absorption resulting in the change the amplitude phase spectra recorded in the signal high frequency harmonic attenuate filter. So over here you can see at 0 second our signal was like this, and then 1 second it reduces like this, then 2 second, 3, 4, and fifth, and this all. So at least if you go into the 5 second deep, then your amplitude is very small. And this on the right side is the amplitude spectrum of the same signals. So for that case, actually we have some factors, which is called the Q factor, which improve the absorption effect, and the transmission losses, which can be covered by the wave conversion. So the decay depends on your time and frequency both. So you have this expression to know about the time and your frequency. So there are some standard values which represent for each and every rock. So let's say if you have the limestone, granite, shale, sandstone. So you can use the Q attenuation filter, which can increase your Q absorption, which is amplitude decay with the depth. So you can enhance your signal based on these values. So normally in the industry, or we have these different type of subsurface material, but we can choose the in between, let's say 100 or 150 Q values, which can recover the most of your decay amplitude with the depth. Thank you so much. I hope you have learned something from this video. Hope to see you again in the next video. Thank you.